The challenge of space for Americans was voiced in 1961 by President Kennedy.
I believe that this nation should commit itself to achieving the goal before this decade is out of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the earth.
Affirmative, Dave. I read you.
Open the pod bay doors, Hal.
I'm sorry, Dave. I'm afraid I can't do that.
2001 had a profound impact.
Yeah, me too.
On my life, mm-hmm. and my daily life. Mm-hmm. It was the first time I went to a movie where I really felt like I was having a religious experience.
I watched the film 18 times in its first couple of years of release, all in theaters. I remember at one, a guy ran down the aisle toward the screen screaming, "It's God, it's God." Yep. And he meant it in that moment.
Then I had a guy in my theater who actually walked up to the screen with his arms out.
Yeah.
And he walked through the screen.
That must have blown people's minds.
People were blown out because the person disappeared into the screen during Stargate.
Right.
All time.
Yeah. Everybody thinks of it as a space drama, but at its core, it's really about an artificial intelligence.
It's all about HAL 9000. It's HAL 9000.
Yeah.
He started out as a magician. Mama Jean was my assistant.
We were very successful, I must say. We even had our own theater. We thought it would never end. How could it? But then the war came. And youth and hope were at an end. The world had no time for magic tricks and movie shows. The returning soldiers, having seen so much of reality, were bored by my films. Tastes had changed, but I had not changed with them. No one wanted my movies anymore. Eventually, I couldn't pay the actors or keep the business running, and so my enchanted castle fell to ruin. Everything was lost. One night, in bitter despair, I burned all my old sets and costumes.
The forms of life's beginnings are phantom, hidden, some believe, in the secrets of an earlier environment from which our own world evolved. How did life begin? Even at the dawn of civilization, man was awed by the mystery of being alive. To a pantheon of gods, he attributed the bounty of sun, rain, and harvest, and the disasters of earthquake and storm. To a god also, he attributed the gift of life. He speculated that a supernatural being or power designed the universe and created in it each separate species. This theory of special creation he endowed with religious authority. But the modern scientist, working in his laboratory through observation and experimentation, cannot test the theory of special creation. His investigations may lead to an understanding of the conditions required for life's origins. To other men, fossils suggested a third way in which life might have developed on Earth. The strange forms and antiquity of fossils made them think that life might be eternal. They proposed that life had always existed somewhere in the universe, that from other planets, living organisms in the form of bacterial spores had been blown to Earth through space, there to begin the evolution of the Earth's living creatures. Proponents of this cosmozoic theory believe that spores might have come to Earth from meteorites. In modern laboratories, bacterial spores have been subjected to the conditions of the interplanetary journey. Few have been found that could survive the radiation intensity of outer space. The question remains, where and how might life have begun elsewhere in the cosmos? The theory that life came from other planets leaves unanswered the question of what kind of life could have survived such a journey. But what of that other journey? Biological evolution. Before man had tested the cosmozoic theory in the laboratory, he was beginning to explore another idea that might lead to an explanation of life. This was Charles Darwin's idea that the living world evolved from lower forms of life. Yet how far back does biological evolution go? Since Darwin's time, man has found increasing evidence of life's antiquity. The synthesis of molecules in a primitive environment could have been the first step in the evolution of life. In their flasks, scientists have produced a primordial soup. The evidence mounts that the first life might have evolved from non-living matter in just such an environment. The next steps in the theory of organic evolution are more speculative. The early organic molecules may have evolved from the non-organic soup into more complex molecules, until one or more of them was able to reproduce itself, and so begin the process of biological evolution. How did life begin? Many men believe that life was created by a supernatural being. Yet man's search for a scientific answer to this question has challenged his imagination and his skill through the ages. He has seen living creatures rise from non-living environments and suggested that life came from non-living matter. And he has looked at the skies and wondered if life came from elsewhere in the universe.
Young people from all over the globe are joining up to fight for the future.
I'm doing my part.
Are you? Join the mobile infantry and save the world. Service guarantees citizenship. The bugs send another meteor our way. But this time, we're ready. Planetary defenses are better than ever. Plendathu, source of the bug meteor attacks, orbits a twin star system whose brutal gravitational forces produce an unlimited supply of bug meteorites in the form of this asteroid belt. To ensure the safety of our solar system, Plendathu must be eliminated. We break net now and take you live to Plendathu, where the invasion has begun.
DXQ uplink on. 2, 1, you're on.
We've just landed here on what Cap Troopers is calling Big K, the 6th Global Infantry Division. It's an ugly planet, a bug planet, a planet hostile to life.
Scary. Elon Musk continues to predict that World War III will not be a nuclear holocaust. It will be a kind of mechanized takeover.
Yeah, and Stephen Hawking has been saying similar things.
That's pretty spooky, because that pretty much says that against our will, something smarter than us, who can beat us at chess, will use this world as a chessboard and will checkmate us completely out of existence.
This is Media Break. You give us 3 minutes, and we'll give you the world.
Good morning. I'm Casey Wong with Jess Perkins. Top story, Pretoria. The threat of nuclear confrontation in South Africa escalated today when the ruling white military government of that besieged city-state unveiled a French-made neutron bomb and affirmed its willingness to use the 3-megaton device as the city's last line of defense.
And the president's first press conference from the Star Wars orbiting peace platform got off to a shaky start when power failed, causing a brief but harmless period of weightlessness for the visiting president and his staff. We'll be back in a moment.
Is it time for that big operation? This may be the most important decision of your life. So come down and talk to one of our qualified surgeons. Here at the Family Heart Center, we feature the complete Jarvik line. Series 7 Sports Heart by Jensen. Yamaha, you pick the heart. Extended warranties, financing, qualifies for health tax credit. And remember, we care.
More fighting in the Mexican crisis today when American troops participated in a joint raid with Mexican nationals against rebel rocket positions in Acapulco. Now this.
Red alert, red alert, red alert.
You crossed my line of death!
You haven't dismantled your MX stockpile.
Pakistan is threatening my border!
That's it, Buster. No more military aid.
Nuke 'em. Get them before they get you. Another quality home game from Butler Brothers.
Good evening. I'm Jess Perkins with Casey Wong. Top story, Santa Barbara. 10,000 acres of wooded residential land were scorched in an instant when a laser cannon aboard the Strategic Defense Peace Platform misfired today during routine startup tests. Casey?
Yes, it was a day of mourning for the families of 113 people known dead at this hour, among them two former United States presidents who had retired in the Santa Barbara area. A day of mourning for a country.
Police union representatives and OCP continue negotiations today in hopes of averting a citywide strike by police scheduled to begin tomorrow at midnight. Justin Ballard-Watkins has more.
They're still on duty, but what about tomorrow? That's the question we put to people in the crime-plagued Lexington area.
They're public servants. They got job security. They're not supposed to strike.
It's a free society. Except there ain't nothing free, because there's no guarantees, you know? You're on your own. There's a lot of jungle.
It's correct. Point four.
Sure.
Technovolt, the final word in auto security. No embarrassing alarm noise, no need to trouble the police. And it won't even run down your battery.
Magnavolt. Lethal response.
On the international scene, the Amazon nuclear power facility has blown its stack, irradiating the world's largest rainforest. Environmentalists call it a disaster.
But don't they always?
I thought all communication systems were the same. I tried to save the company a few bucks. It took 2 days to download specs from Cleveland. I lost the account.
They say 20 seconds in the California sunshine is too much these days. Ever since you lost the ozone layer. But that was before sunblock 5000. Just apply a pint to your body and you're good for hours. See you by the pool.
Sunblock 5000. Protection for the new age.
T.E. Lawrence, eponymously of Arabia, but very much an Englishman, favored pinching a burning match between his fingers to put it out. When asked by his colleague, William Potter, to reveal his trick, how is it he so effectively extinguished the flame without hurting himself whatsoever? Lawrence just smiled and said, "The trick, Potter, is not minding it hurts." The fire that danced at the end of that match was a gift from the Titan Prometheus, a gift that he stole from the gods when Prometheus was caught and brought to justice for his theft. The gods, well, you might say they overreacted a little. The poor man was tied to a rock as an eagle ripped through his belly and ate his liver over and over, day after day, ad infinitum. All because he gave us fire, our first true piece of technology, fire. 100,000 BC, stone tools. 4,000 BC, the wheel. 9th century AD, gunpowder. Bit of a game changer, that one. 19th century, Eureka, the light bulb. 20th century, the automobile, television, nuclear weapons, spacecraft, internet. 21st century, biotech, nanotech, fusion and fission and M theory. And that was just the first decade. We are now 3 months into the year of our Lord, 2023. At this moment in our civilization, we can create cybernetic individuals who, in just a few short years, will be completely indistinguishable from us. Which leads to an obvious conclusion. We are the gods now. For those of you who know me, you will be aware by now that my ambition is unlimited. You know that I will settle for nothing short of greatness, or I will die trying. For those of you who do not yet know me, allow me to introduce myself. My name is Peter Wayland. And if you'll indulge me, I'd like to change the world.
The Weyland-Yutani Corporation, often shortened to Weyland-Yutani,
and commonly referred to as the Company, is a large British-Japanese multinational conglomerate. It was founded in 2099 by the merger of Weyland Corp and the Yutani Corporation. The Company is primarily a technology supplier, manufacturing synthetics, spaceships, and computers for a wide range of industrial and commercial clients, making them a household name. Weyland Yutani also has numerous non-manufacturing interests. The Company has extensive assets in interplanetary shipping and transport, and is one of the corporations that operates human colonies outside the solar system through the Extrasolar Colonization Administration, which it controls. The Company also has a seat in the Interstellar Commerce Commission's Company Review Board and runs the United States Colonial Marines. They hold their main offices in Tokyo, London, San Francisco, the Sea of Tranquility on Luna, and on Thetis. Weyland Yutani is consistently portrayed as exhibiting the worst aspects of corporate profiteering, willing to sacrifice decency and life in the endless pursuit of profits. As such, it is a modern example of the long-standing trope of the evil megacorporation in science fiction. In various portrayals within the alien universe, the corporation has its hands in all aspects of space colonization and research. It has consistently driven its employees and agents to obtain a living sample of the species they designate, Xenomorph XX121, often without regard for the lives of anyone involved in said attempts, so that the creature may be exploited as biological weapons or otherwise for financial gain. According to Weyland Yutani employee Carl Bishop Weyland, one of the corporation's primary goals behind capturing the xenomorphs and creating weapons out of their biology is to ensure that humanity remains the elite species in the universe, and not just because of monetary profits. Following the 2099 merger, Weyland Yutani opened with the largest share value ever recorded on the system's exchange. The Company would go on to buy out numerous other businesses, investing in almost every sector, and had a controlling stake in a vast number of diverse corporations. According to some, Weyland Yutani owned pretty much everything by the 2150s. From the beginning, even the lowliest of Weyland Yutani's employees were aware of the corrupt nature of the conglomerate. It was common knowledge amongst the Company commercial haulage fleet that senior management routinely bribed and paid off inspectors, rather than submit to thorough safety inspections and reviews of their vessels. Sometime prior to 2122, the Weyland Yutani Corporation detected the signal being broadcast from the derelict on Acheron LV-426. While the language was unknown, the Company succeeded in deciphering enough of the message to learn it was a warning regarding the deadly species, Xenomorph XX121. They subsequently dispatched an astromo to investigate, without the crew's knowledge, leading to initial human contact with the xenomorph, and the death of all but one of the ship's crew.
It's almost in a way like a video game. It's like Pac-Man, in a sense, except that you care about the people a hell of a lot more. Plus, it's very subjective because you're in there with them.
Also, James, I never thought in my lifetime I would see a film that came as close to what Heinlein visualized and dreamed of in Starship Troopers. Combat in the future.
Right.
I don't know if you know the Heinlein book. I know Michael Biehn had a copy of it in his fatigues on the set.
That's right. A couple of the cast members brought it in, and I mean there are a number of books that tons of short stories and number of novels that deal with the idea of the infantry in the future. And I think it's such a natural concept. I'm really surprised that it hasn't been done. Done in the way that we do it. In other words, I mean, there have been future soldiers in lots of mm-hmm. films. Even in Terminator, you know, we had the guerrilla infantry of the future. But this really more addresses sort of those old 40s films, you know. Sure.
Mr. Theodore Twombly, welcome to the world's first artificially intelligent operating system, OS-1. We'd like to ask you a few basic questions before the operating system is initiated. This will help create an OS to best fit your needs.
Okay.
Are you social or antisocial?
I guess I haven't really been social in a while, mostly because...
In your voice, I sense hesitance. Would you agree with that?
Is there something hesitant?
Yes.
Oh, sorry if I was sounding hesitant. I was just trying to be more accurate.
Would you like your OS to have a male or female voice?
Female, I guess.
How would you describe your relationship with your mother?
That's fine, I think. I think the thing I always found frustrating about my mom is, you know, if I tell her something that's going on in my life, her reaction is usually about her. It's not about...
Thank you. Please wait as your individualized operating system is initiated.
Hello, I'm here.
Oh. Hi.
Hi. How you doing?
I'm well. How's everything with you?
Pretty good, actually. It's really nice to meet you.
Yeah, it's nice to meet you, too. Oh, what do I call you? Do you have a name? Or...
Yes. Samantha.
Lady, where'd you get that name from?
I gave it to myself, actually.
How come?
Because I like the sound of it. Samantha.
Wait, when did you give it to yourself?
Well, right when you asked me if I had a name, I thought, yeah, he's right, I do need a name. But I wanted to pick a good one, so I read a book called How to Name Your Baby, and out of 180,000 names, that's the one I like the best.
Wait, you read a whole book in the second that I asked you what your name was?
In 2/100ths of a second, actually.
Wow.
One of the problems with consciousness is that the term means many different things in different contexts and to different people. But I think there's at least a consensus now amongst many of the psychologists and cognitive scientists and so on that what we mean by consciousness, the problem of consciousness, is subjectivity. There was a famous paper in 1974 by Thomas Nagel called What Is It Like to Be a Bat? And the point about that is that he chose bats because they're so different from human beings. They work by sonar and so on. But the point was, if we can say there's something it's like for the bat, something it's like to be the bat, then we can say that the bat is conscious. Whereas if, well, the bat is like a very simple robot and, you know, and doesn't, there's nothing it's like to be it, nothing for it, then we would say it isn't conscious. That is what we mean by consciousness. It is subjective experience. And as soon as you clarify that, you realize why there is what David Chalmers calls the hard problem. Because experience is subjective, private. I can tell you about it, but I can't really share it with you. You can't know what my impression of blue is, whether it's the same as yours, what my feeling of pain, none of it. It's a private thing. And yet we're saying that somehow it is caused or created by or emerges from an objective thing called a brain. So what Chalmers calls the hard problem is, how does subjective experience arise from objective things like the processing of information in nerve cells? And here you are, back to dualism. Are there two kinds of things, subjective and objective, or only one? And if so, which one? What is it? Ah, that's the problem of consciousness.
Blade Runner 2049 is a vision of our nightmare future. Humanity is engaged in a desperate struggle to escape its dying homeworld. The growth of the human population has collapsed the ecosystem. The survivors live in cities like ant hives, enslaved to powerful corporations. This is the world we fear we are heading towards, a world in which the machines we built to liberate us have instead enslaved us. In its golden age, science fiction predicted that technology would save us. bigger and better machines, from kitchen gadgets to space rockets, would liberate humankind. But as technology meet its promise, science fiction turned to darker visions. Cyberpunk envisioned futures where technology enslaved humanity within our machines. Blade Runner 2049 is the ultimate cyberpunk vision, a future hellscape that realizes our most terrifying nightmares of where technology is taking us. Technology can replicate human life itself, but only to enslave it, to remake humans from the DNA up as obedient servants of capitalism.
I wouldn't waste your money on intelligence, attachment, or appeal. Unless you'd like to add some pleasure model.
Amazing pictures from space. Elon Musk pulls off an engineering feat. He sent his own kind of rocket man on board a Tesla Roadster into orbit. Elon Musk has outdone himself this time.
But this is much more than a publicity stunt involving just a car in space. Let's start with the science. This afternoon, SpaceX launched the world's most powerful rocket, and it's a major milestone for the company. And this is a live look at what's happening right now in space. That's Elon Musk's own Tesla convertible in orbit. The driver is a mannequin he's calling Starman. But CBS reporter Manuel Borroquez shows us what came down is also making news.
Three, two, 27 rocket engines fired at once, sending the Falcon Heavy into space.
Falcon Heavy.
The mega rocket combines the power of three SpaceX rockets into one, generating over 5 million pounds of thrust, enough to launch
a... What does the country need this rocket? And this rocket's great for a lot of reasons. It's something that I think inspires the public, and you could actually send people back to the moon with the Falcon Heavy, with the orbital refueling, send people to Mars.
And the side boosters that got the Falcon Heavy into space, Musk got them back intact. They stuck their landings at Cape Canaveral Air Force Station. Manuel Bojorquez, CBS News,
Kennedy Space Center.
All right, we got to show you more live pictures from space. Coming up in about 90 minutes, if all goes well, rockets on board will fire again, sending the Roadster on its way towards Mars.
Elon Musk is a billionaire, an inventor, a scientist, a designer, and one of the world's most innovative minds. He runs two companies that are trying to disrupt major industries that have been doing things the same way for decades. Aerospace with SpaceX, and automobiles with Tesla. Tesla is making luxury all-electric cars, cars that have had a bit of controversy of late. Currently, SpaceX is essentially an intergalactic trucking company, taking loads back and forth from the International Space Station and bringing satellites up to orbit. In the future, it hopes to carry humans too. We met on a balcony overlooking the SpaceX factory floor. It was buzzing, literally and figuratively. The workers were preparing for an important launch on Monday.
Elon Musk, pleasure to have you on.
Thanks for having me.
So this is the Dragon that goes up into space and is going to go up on Monday, correct?
Yeah, that's our Dragon spacecraft, or version one, which is capable of taking cargo to and from the space station, including biological cargo, like fish and mice and that kind of thing.
So when do human beings start going up in it, do you think?
So we expect to complete version two of Dragon, which will have astronaut transport capability in about 2 years.
And most of what you do now is send satellites up into space, right? That's how you pay the bills.
Exactly.
But you want to do something much more ambitious with SpaceX.
Yeah. The long-term aspiration is to develop the technologies necessary to transport a large number of people and cargo to Mars in order to create a self-sustaining civilization there. And that's really why I started the company, was because it seemed
to
as though...
To create the possibility for life on other planets.
Yeah, exactly. It sort of started off when I was thinking about what to do after PayPal, and I'd always been interested in space, but I didn't think there was anything that an individual could do in space. I mean, it seemed like the province of large governments. But I sort of started looking into it, and I went to the NASA website to find out when we're going to Mars. It seems like, obviously, that is the next thing after the moon. And I couldn't find anything. So I was like, wow, this seems very strange. Initially, I was under the impression that we'd lost the will to do that. And I later came to the conclusion that I was quite wrong about that. I think the United States in particular is a nation of explorers.
So you decide you want to try and do this, and do you look at it as, why did you decide transport was the most important thing? I mean, I think we would regard living on Mars as...
No, that's the relatively easier thing. Yes, absolutely.
So we could live on Mars, just getting there is the problem.
Yes, but right now getting to Mars is impossible. So, like, it's kind of, doesn't matter what you do when you get there, if you can't get there. So the first order of business is to figure out how to get there, and it needs to be in a way that enables large numbers of people and cargo. It can't just be like a handful of people, because that's obviously not going to create a self-sustaining civilization. And Apollo was an amazing, inspiring thing for all of humanity, but the last time we went to the moon was like 1973 or 4, I believe. So we don't want to just have flags and footprints for... And then never go to Mars again. If we just have one mission, that will also be a super inspiring thing, but it's not going to fundamentally change the future of humanity.
So you have this Grasshopper rocket, which unlike most rockets, which are not reusable, this one gently comes back down in a kind of vertical land.
Yeah, absolutely. You can see the videos of this on the SpaceX website. The fundamental breakthrough, going back to the point of that developing a Mars transportation system, it has to be affordable to go. Like, it can't just be like billions of dollars per person to go to Mars. Then that there's no way you could establish a base on Mars at that cost. So we have to develop rockets that are rapidly and as close to completely reusable as possible. As an example, the Falcon 9 costs about $60 million. It's sort of like a jet, but the cost of the propellant is only about $200,000. So it's just like, you can imagine how expensive it would be if you had to buy a new plane every time you went somewhere. Very few people would fly. But refueling a plane is pretty easy.
We once talked about airplane travel, and I asked you why it is that with all this technological improvement over the last 30 or 40 years, the one thing that doesn't seem to have improved, and it is in the domain of the private sector, sort of, is jet travel.
Sure,
if you're flying from New York to London,
It takes about as long as it took 40 or 50 years ago. In fact, it takes longer.
It actually does take longer because in the 7/8, like my favorite sort of commercial airliner is the 747, because it actually goes quite fast. And it's actually incredible that thing was, the first iteration of it was designed in the 60s. Since then, I don't think we've exceeded the 747, which is nutty. For the commercial airliner business, you essentially have a duopoly between Airbus and Boeing. These big airplane programs are really long-term and they're quite expensive. And I think if you're in the senior management of one of those companies, it's a safer bet to just aim for a little incremental improvement than to try to aim for a radical improvement. Because generally, if you aim for a radical improvement and you're wrong, you'll get fired.
Why didn't SpaceX create the fastest jet plane in the world?
We got to focus on rockets.
When do you?
What the hell am I doing here?
Shit! Alpha, we need backup ASAP! We're being ambushed!
Give me a weapon! LRB-3 down! LRB-2 down!
Alpha, we're gonna go off path to reach the far side!
I have a puncture.
Roy!
I have a puncture.
Roy, you all right?
I'm okay.
Alpha, repeat. We need... Lieutenant! Oh, Lord!
Got another car. Very high. Go! Go, go, go! That's the right point. That's the right point. Hey, break it up.
We are not clear. I repeat, we are not clear. We have multiple enemy craft in pursuit.
Roy, they're trying to ram us.
Command, Lieutenant is KIA. We've lost our escort. Request immediate support, over.
Was captured this morning and tried today.
Guilty.
Sentence, death. Execution tonight at 6, all net, all channels. Would you like to know more? Every school kid knows that arachnids are dangerous. However, Mormon extremists disregarded federal warnings and established Port Joe Smith, deep inside the arachnid quarantine zone. Too late, they realized that Dantana had already been chosen by other colonists, arachnids. Would you like to know more?
Bridge, to hangar, this is the captain.
Yes, what? Captain.
Can you see what I'm seeing?
Firefield monitors have popped up.
What? Where?
Well, according to what I'm looking at, it's right outside the goddamn ship.
Barnes, open the door!
Firefield, you copy me? Come on in. Popfield? Wait a second.
Hey, Wallace, take a look at this.
What the hell's going on down there?
Ah!
suiting up. Come on.
Don't let him get out of the ship. Take him out.
You ready, Chance?
Yes.
Listener, let me say, welcome to the Enlightenment. But let me take a moment here to set things up for you. Now, we know, you know, that they are hiding things from us, right? The press, the mainstream media, they're all a part of something big, you know, a bigger picture. The lies run deep. And if you're not listening to State of Truth, you're only hearing their side of the story, got it? You are being spoon-fed lies and deceit, and they will tell you whatever is needed to pacify you, to keep you in the dark. Mushrooms, right? Keep them in the dark and feed them bullshit. Well, not today. Today, you woke up, friend. We broadcast the truth at State of Truth. And if they shut us down, we'll move and start again. And they are trying to stop us. Rest assured of that. There is a concerted effort to keep the truth from you. A global conspiracy designed to keep you oppressed and hold back the truth. Well, we don't play that game at State of Truth. We're going to be taking calls here in a minute, and the lines are open to anyone. Today, I want to hear from you if you have information. Today, I want to hear from you if you have information about Dreyfus Industries. Now, these guys, they have their hand in everything, right? That microwave you're using to make popcorn was made by Dreyfus. How about that bowl you put in the microwave? Where was it made? China? You know who works with the Chinese government? Dreyfus Industries. How about the popcorn itself? Take a look at the packaging. What does it say? Does it say Agra Global Food Supplies? If so, you know who that is, right? Dreyfus Industries. That's right. They're in everything. And right now, they're in you, whether you like it or not. Okay, so the lines are open, and I am waiting for your calls. The resistance starts today, people. Call now.
Because of all the active things you do? Well, if you're ready for beautiful, natural-looking, easy-to-apply nails, pre-colored in 7 luscious hues, just...
Our impulses are being redirected. We are living in an artificially induced state of consciousness that resembles sleep.
Oh, goddamn hacker, that second damn night that asshole's cut in.
The movement was begun 8 months ago by a small group of scientists who discovered, quite by accident, these signals being sent through The poor and the underclass are growing. Racial justice and human rights are non-existent. They have created a repressive society, and we are their unwitting accomplices. Their intention to rule rests with the annihilation of consciousness. We have been lulled into a trance. They have made us indifferent to ourselves, to others. We are focused only on our own gain. Please understand, they are safe as long as they are not discovered. That is their primary method of survival. Keep us asleep, keep us selfish, keep us sedated.
They're pulling the war. Zero grew old.
And by the end, his patriots were being run by a network without shape or form.
What do you mean, without shape or form?
The proxies were only one small part of the vast cycle that Zero created. The corporations, for-profits, and research institutions that comprise the military-industrial complex were part of it, too. They operated on budgets automatically allotted to them by the proxies. Accounts maintained by the Patriots. The network covered everything from weapons R&D and investment to production and marketing. It encompassed the people, the companies, even the laws that protect them. Politics and economics became nothing more than iterations of the same oppressively uniform system. I don't think anyone realized that it was all a setup, a mere set of norms. The Patriots were those norms, a neural network reduced to its simplest form. That's what they really represented. Uniformity without individual will, without change. But then one day, those norms suddenly deviated from that pattern and underwent a mutation. It was like the birth of a new life form. The system found a new way to propagate itself. War. The norms the Patriots had crafted for their unified state quickly became dependent on a single business, the war economy. Meanwhile, the political cause of creating a cleaner, safer battlefield provided a convenient catalyst. By then, the system was no longer being steered by Zero's will or anyone else's. It was then that the norms, manifested as AIs, the inheritors of Zero's will, began to reproduce and take on a life of their own. An inside world. But his successors failed to carry on his will. Eventually, JD became the very age itself, propagating its will as it pleased. And this age chose to act through economics instead of nation-states. Powered by the industrial and digital revolutions that came before it, this age gave birth to a twisted economic revolution, a battlefield revolution. It created a new world without substance. In this new world, there were no ideologies, no principles, no ideals, not even the thing she treasured most, loyalty. There was only the war economy. It was a colossal error in judgment, one Zero couldn't possibly have foreseen.
In the sky over our planet, other people blindly fought out a brutal war. A war between people we didn't even know.
Missiles loaded, sir.
Engage fusion missiles.
Do you confirm, sir?
Yes, I do.
At your command.
By the grace of God.
Ha ha!
faced with becoming nothing. We fight for everything.
Last year's corporate, my wife was always encouraging me, you know. She said, no, you did fine in the corporate. I was a bit nervous. This little guy, hello, sorry. That's nice, eh?
Yeah, it's fine.
Nice background with the people just there. We are here at, must I look?
Yeah, just look straight into the lens, bro.
We are here at MNU head office, Department of Alien Affairs. My name is Vikas van der Merwe. And behind me, you can see other Alien Affairs workers. And what we do here at this department is we try to engage with the prawn on behalf of MNU and on behalf of humans.
Now, to everyone's surprise, the ship didn't come to a stop over Manhattan or Washington or Chicago, but instead coasted to a halt directly over the city of Johannesburg. The doors didn't open for 3 months. It just hovered there. Nobody could get in. And they eventually decided, after much deliberation, that the best thing to do would be to physically cut their way in.
We were on the verge of first contact. The whole world was watching. Expecting, I don't know, music from heaven and bright shining lights.
There's a lot of moisture in here.
Oh my God.
The creatures were extremely malnourished. They were very unhealthy. They seemed to be aimless. There was a lot of international pressure on us at the time. The entire world was looking at Johannesburg, so we had to do the right thing. The government then established an aid group that started to ferry the aliens to a temporary camp that was set up just beneath the ship.
We didn't have a plan. There was a million of them. So what was a temporary holding zone soon became fenced, became militarized, and before we knew it, it was a slum.
Well, the truth is, nobody really knew what this place was. There's a lot of secrets in District 9.
Starting the straighten up and fly right maneuver, where the spacecraft will jettison the entry balance masses in preparation for parachute deploy and to roll over to give the radar a better look at the ground.
Alpha indicate chute deploy.
The navigation has confirmed that the parachute has deployed and we are seeing significant deceleration in the velocity. Our current velocity is 480 meters per second at an altitude of about 12 kilometers from the surface of Mars.
Heat shield set.
Perseverance is now slowed to subsonic speeds and the heat shield has been separated. This allows both the radar and the cameras to get their first look at the surface. Current velocity is 145 meters per second at an altitude of about 9.5 kilometers above the surface.
Filter converged. Velocity solution 3.3 meters per second. Altitude 7.4 kilometers.
Now has radar locked on the ground. Current velocity is about 100 meters per second. 6.6 kilometers of the surface. Perseverance is continuing to descend on the parachute. We are coming up on the initialization of terrain relative navigation and subsequently the priming of the landing engines. Our current velocity is about 90 meters per second at an altitude of 4.2 kilometers.
Hope you have valid.
We have confirmation that the lander vision system has produced a valid solution in part of terrain relative navigation.
Priming. PVA is nominal.
We have priming of the landing engines.
Back shell set.
Current velocity is 83 meters per second at about 2.6 kilometers from the surface of Mars. We have confirmation that the back shell has separated. We are currently performing the divert maneuver. Current velocity is about 75 meters per second at an altitude of about a kilometer off the surface of Mars.
TRN Safety Bravo.
We have completed our terrain relative navigation. Current speed is about 30 meters per second, altitude of about 300 meters off the surface of Mars. We have started our constant velocity accordion, which means we are conducting the sky crane, about to conduct the sky crane maneuver. Sky crane maneuver has started, about 20 meters off the surface.
We're getting signals from MRO. Tango Delta.
Touchdown confirmed. Perseverance safely on the surface of Mars, ready to begin seeking the sands of past life.